Good morning, good morning. This is Rose Ruder on 10 a.m. live on Facebook. And I just welcome you this morning to this live. And we're waiting for a few people still to come on. And then we're going to get going. So thank you, Jesus, for your amazing grace. Good morning, Elizabeth. Straight away, lovely to see you, Elizabeth and Lani. Great to see you. Hi, Melanie, lovely to see you. And Helga. Hi, Rona. And so lovely to see you, Veronica Goodyear. Hi, Liz Nielsen. Lovely to see you. Hello, Lorena. Thank you, Liz. Hi, Helen. Hello, Linda Hapgood. Scottish lass. Living in Scotland. You're a Scottish lass. Good morning, Kim. Good morning, Heidi Steiger. Good morning, Michelle Marquis, Leslie Blankenberg. Ah, thank you, Elizabeth. She says, highlight of the day. Morning, Jackie. Good that you could join this morning. Morning, Sharon. Thank you, Veronica. She says, great to tune in again. And then we have another Veronica. Hello, Celeste Heldenhaes. And then we've got Veronica Schultz. Judith Jacobs. Shirley, good morning. Leah Rattle, good morning. Pamela Lloyd, good morning. Lorena, saying good morning to everybody. Vilna Steenkamp. Benolia from Christchurch, New Zealand. Wonderful to see you today. Jules Buerta, good morning. Diane Santiago, good morning. Precious daughter of the King. Oh, Anzal. Another one. Anzal Lopcha, another one that's had a huge, 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 huge breakthrough in our God. Such favor. Shabbat Shalom, says Erica. Good morning, Robert. Great to see you. Crystal, good morning. Yes, Liz Boots. Hey, Liz, my pal from England, near Chester. Good to have you on board. Good morning, Craig from the UK. Good to have you on board. Morning, Teresa van Beek. Morning, Craig. Good morning, Glynis. Good morning, Tundi. Good morning, Jenny Hardesty. Yoo-hoo. All my favorites are online today. Good morning, Glynis. Lovely to see you online. Good morning, good morning. Ah, don't worry, Juliana. We're only just getting going. I've only just put the camera on. Just greeting still. Good morning, Debbie Minter. Good morning, good morning. Teresa Nordi, lovely to have you. I love it. Tundi says, Goeiemôre almal. Good Afrikaans there, Tundi. Carlene Babs, lovely to see you. May, wonderful to see you. Yoo-hoo, May Raphael, she's an amazing minister of the gospel. And May, I want to say to you as well, later on, if we flow in the prophetic, we see where it goes, that you are also welcome to type up any words that we flow with, what you want to add, yeah. Belinda Michael, good morning. Colin van Rooyen, good morning, Colin van Rooyen. Lovely to have you. Good morning, Enna. Karen Christensen. Come on, Lord. Send her back via the airwaves now. Juliana, greeting Apostle Liz Boot from UK. Good morning, Maureen. Faithful, faithful woman of God. Sure, I'm sorry about that for you, Liz. I'm going to just keep going and trust Papa God that internet will not go in and out, and that it will be a clear picture and clear sound. Leslie Blankenberg from Spirit Life Church. Lovely to have you. Raynell, welcome. Sylvia, welcome. Mariki Van Sale, welcome. Carol Lotz, welcome. Nikki Fandrakis, good morning. Immaculate John, good morning. Good morning. Siobhan Pfeiffer, oh, this is lovely to have you on board, Siobhan. I'm so glad I understand the spelling of that name. When you look at it, you cannot say Siobhan phonetically because it'll be Sio Bohan. Siobhan Pfeiffer. It's very Irish. Joe Bransbury and Carol Lotz. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Craig, greeting Pastor Liz Boot as well. Good morning. Lovely to see you. Sean. Mustard. Ashley Elgar, good morning. Marinda Brits, good morning. Cindy Lont, good morning. Wow. Okay, so Nikki says only able to stay till 10:30 because of another Zoom meeting, but really need a word, please. Okay, so Nikki needs a word. And those that are prophetic and coming on board, during the morning or even before 10:30, if you want to type up a word for her, that'll be great. Shame. Debbie also says that screen has been freezing a lot. Good morning, Almin. Shall we pray? I mean, there's 65 of us already. We should pray. Father, thank you for this morning. We pray over the airwaves that we will have a good clear sound, a good uninterrupted picture, and that the internet will and the Wi-Fi will remain strong in each and every home, that the word that comes forth this morning will not be lost, that we will take hold of it with both hands, and that we will walk in the fullness of what you are unloading to us this morning by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning, Jenny Heinemann. Lovely to see you. A few people have said the connection's not very good this morning, but I'm going to just continue. I'm going to minister, and I'm going to ask that if it does come in and out, that you're able to go back and listen to it later today. I want to speak on quite a serious subject today. Serious, but not serious, because it's all part of the plan of God. So let's start by our perception of God is limited, but His perception of us is limitless. And we need to give ourselves permission to live by the Spirit. Because right now, we are living in a very, very serious time frame. And as a prophetic vessel, I would be falling, if I do not speak the truth, I would fall into the category of the people's pleasing prophet and giving you things that are just going to tickle your ears and make you feel good. But I want to say to you, you see this painting behind me? I'm going to take the camera across there. So this painting is called from the Psalms, Deep Calls to Deep at the Sound of Your Waterfalls. See, the waterfall of God, there's two trees on the side. Deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfalls. And we are in a season where there is a deep, deep cry from God's children to Him and from God to His children. We are going to learn to live more and more out of the spiritual stream that we have inside of us, and not what is measurable by man. And so we need to start leaning heavily into the waterfalls, the watercourses of God. Looking up that scripture that goes with that painting from Psalms, it says, deep calls to deep. I think it's Psalm 42, verse 7. Deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfall. And so Father is calling us. So it's I see there's a delay. I think I want to continue with this, but I think I'm just going to call to the kids upstairs and ask them that if they are all streaming, because there's multiple devices, I'm going to ask them if they wouldn't mind just giving me a little bit of space to do my live. Would you excuse me just for a few minutes? I'm just going to find out. I'm back, and the mommy is going upstairs to make sure that there aren't three Xboxes running at this moment. And I think I'm going to even switch off the music, that it's not going to be contending the smart TV. All these things just absorb the signal. Okay, so I've asked them to please just stay off all the extra devices, which is very unusual because we have very fast and uncapped internet. Right, we're back. Sorry about that. I do apologize. So Father is, there's a deep place in God that is calling to a deep place inside of us. And we do not want to miss the day of God's visitation. That Father, thank you, I'm glad to hear it's better, that Father is preparing us, His children, to come fully in to living by the Spirit. Because we need to live in spirit and in truth. That's right. Psalm 42, verse 7. Thank you, Shirley, for always coming back with the scripture and helping on that. So we need to live in spirit and in truth. We need to live by the Spirit. For the systems of this world are dark. Dark. And the Word of God warns us that there will be darkness on the earth and deep darkness on the people. And so I want to start preparing you, if not by many, then by few, that even Noah never got to convince beyond his family that they needed to turn from their wicked ways Yes, our salvation totally covers us. But there are some scriptures in the New Testament. For instance, the words of Jesus are, when he returns to the earth, when he returns, will he find faith in the earth? There are people whose faith will fail them. And then the scripture of the 10 virgins, that we need to be trimming our wicks and make, and trimming the wick talks about a place of deep consecration. Holy, holy, holy. Walking in integrity. Walking in yes is yes and no is no. Walking in transparency. I'm not talking about vulnerability where you let any Joe soap into your life to talk to you. I'm talking about a place of a deep place of submission unto God, a place of surrender unto Him, a place of surrender to the plans that He has for us. A putting our plan on the altar of God and saying, these are my best years and I give them to you, Lord. Remember that we have checked out of this earthly system right now with what is going on. And so if the wick of a lamp is not trimmed, what has happened as the lamp every day is lit, every day that the lamp is lit, there is a thick residue that builds up on the wick. And instead of the flame just being a bright and a clear flame, it lets off the flame, but with it comes these puffs of smoke, black smoke, showing that the lamp of God, which we are, we carry His light, has got mixture or has not been trimmed. The trimming of the wick is to go into the holy, 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 holy place of God and say, Father, that I realize that I have tolerated things in my life that you want to trim. It's forgiven. It's covered by the blood. But we are still seeking to be Christ-like. We're still, there is a preached truth. And there is a positional truth, because we are in Christ, but there's still a daily working out of our salvation. And there's a scripture that says, nothing will separate you from the love of God. Not life, not death, not powers, not principalities, not things that happened before, not things that are happening right now, not things that are still to come. Not life, nor death, not powers, nor principality can separate you from the love of God. And it's a script, it's a wonderful scripture, but if we use it to cover sin and tell everybody that, don't worry, God loves everybody, then we are preaching a half gospel. And so Father has prepared us for a supernatural harvest that I want you to notice, supernatural harvest. So it's not going to come in the systems that we've known. It's not necessarily going to be standing on the corner handing out a tract. Might be, but it's not only. It might not even be taking big and heavy vehicles into Africa with all its expense. That scripture about when he returns, It says, it's in Luke 8, verse 18. Thank you, Celeste. But when the Son of Man returns, how many will he on the earth see on the earth who have faith? So this is not a season, I agree with you, Enna, to dilute the gospel. So Father's going to bring in a supernatural harvest. What does a supernatural harvest look like? Let's unpack that. And you see, God has given us incredible brains. Incredible brains. Yes, Colin. A paradigm shift. I think some of the harvest is coming in, even in homes and behind closed doors, because of the prayers of the martyrs. And I don't want to frighten you, but I do think that martyrdom on the earth today is still a reality. And so as the blood of Jesus cries out from the soil of South Africa, from the UK, from America, from Afghanistan, from Pakistan, from China, from, you have to know that the people of China are not all part of what has gone down now. That there are believers there. Huge underground churches that love God. So we cannot enter into a place of ethnic hatred and hate the Jews and hate the Chinese and hate. The Lord says in his word that let the tares and the wheat grow up together for the day to separate. Even the sheep and the goats will come. This is New Testament teaching. And I feel that I need to, remember when I spoke about the physiotherapist tapping Lionel's thumb to provoke the thumb to be able to move. And if that thumb doesn't move, it won't provoke the rest of the hand and the neural pathways. And when the Lord said, when the OT, she was an OT, when the OT said to me, I need to provoke it so it'll work and get new neural paths, lest it die. If you don't get it working, it's going to end up a gammy limb. And remember, the Lord said to me, just as that is true on a physical body, so it is true in his body. He said, it's a season to provoke each other to walk in the works that God has already prepared for us, to stand up in our giftings, excuse me, to walk in our gift and our calling. And so as one that walks in a prophetic anointing, I want to say to you, awake, O sleeper. Awake, O sleeper. God has cancelled man's competition. God, you are not competing against others. Your call is unto him, and we are all members of one body. We are all under the headship of Christ, not of the headship of an apostle or the headship of a pope or a bishop, a priest. All of those the offices that I have mentioned, all come under the headship of Christ. So we, the body, together in various forms, and each of us has the fullness of Christ inside of us, the gifting of God upon us. It's a season for us to shut the door and hear what it is that he is saying to us. What is it that he is saying to the churches at this time? We cannot leave it for somebody else to decide for us. We need to hear. In the book of Revelations, it says, to those that overcome, I will give you a stone with your name on it. To those that overcome, I will give you this. To those, seven times. And there's always a little but. And that's the last writing. And the writing is on the wall. Let us not again have to wait for the Lord to line up heaven and earth for us to come into that was put on your life for a long time now. We have to, that's right. Marinda Britt says, catch a wake up. We need to catch a wake up. So this morning, just before coming onto the live, I got a WhatsApp from, I feel, quite a reliable source. And I'm not going to say who it is or anything now, because the airwaves can be quite dangerous. So I've got to be very careful. But another person in high authority and a believer that is unpacking the coronavirus agenda, the HIV agenda, the SARS agenda. So lest the Lord, who is calling us to live spirit to spirit, our spirit to his spirit, and even that there's agreement between us, spirit to spirit, and lest he shortens the days for the sake of the elect, we have entered perilous times. Even as I say it, I have to hold back my emotions. I feel emotional because, I tell you why, I don't fear the end. I fear that we, the church, haven't got enough time to finish what we were entrusted with. I urge us together, do not get excited with people that say, God bless you. Oh, bless South Africa. I want you to get excited that this is your season to be part of bringing in a harvest. You have to move your brain from a place of the picture which I painted of Ruth bringing in the sheaves. You've got to move that to what is reality. That is a wonderful analogy and so right. So right. But now we sit with a romantic picture. That somehow everybody is just going to come to Jesus. The word of God says in the New Testament, the fields are ripe unto harvest. Pray that the Lord will thrust out workers. When we say Africa will be saved, let us not go back into an Old Testament model that when Jesus came to the earth, the religious institution thought and the people thought he was coming back to sort out their political arena. We are relying that heaven's going to intervene and we are going to see a harvest and a revival. But I want you to know that he uses mankind. He used Noah. The outpouring in Toronto came by a response of people's hearts when they called unto God to do something. But when he had poured out his spirit, they had to pick up what God was doing and run with it. And so let us not be silent. Let us preach the gospel, the good news, far and wide. We have been set up with this internet that is known as so evil. But the Lord uses all things for his glory. In the very old days before cell phones, we had a couple that lived near us, one of our neighbors. Their evangelistic ministry was that they took the telephone directory and they would phone people and ask them for 3 minutes of their time. And in 3 minutes, they would preach the gospel. And if the person was ready, pray with them the sinner's prayer. They did this systematically from the letter A through the telephone directory, phoning people. I pray that today that the Father will give you such boldness and such opportunity that you will be able to ask those close and those far away, do you know Jesus? Even if you're in the marketplace and you are able to get anybody's attention, because when I went back to, good morning Barbara, lovely to see you online, I'm speaking on the responsibility of winning people to Jesus against a backdrop of perilous times. And even when I first went back to go and do the shopping, I don't leave the house very often. And when I did leave the house, I was so taken up at the courtesy of many men that would wait for me to bring my trolley through. And then I suddenly realized, no, it's not chivalry. It is desperation of survival. That they're not giving way because they're being polite. They're giving way because they want to make space, they want to bring distance. You see, what is innocent to the innocent heart is innocence, and what is suspicion to a suspicious heart is suspicious. And so, but if you're in the marketplace and you happen to be able to ask somebody, particularly the staff, what do you think about this coronavirus? And they start to tell you, what an opportunity to then speak to them about the fact that these could be signs of an end time. And do they know Jesus? And would they like to know Jesus? Because Jesus is coming back to fetch us and take us to the Father. And the only way to Father God, holy, holy, majestic and almighty, is through his Son. Jesus is the door. Often we're looking for new doors and open doors when Jesus is the door, and businesses will fail and shut, you know, business failure. The doors collapsed to my business. But if you stand in the door of Jesus Christ, if you stand in the doorway of Jesus Christ, He will never close on you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He's not going to leave you behind. The Leave Behind series, you know. Oh, there goes my husband and I'm left behind. There must have been, I burnt his eggs the other day. No, listen, people. Your name is written in the your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And your name is inscribed on His hand. But what about those that haven't been asked if they want this Jesus? And so I started this morning by saying our perception of God is so limited. It's limited to who we think we are, to who others think we are, to who we really are. It's limited to how we feel and what we see. It's limited to the fact that we wanted to just, you know, measure a certain way. But I want to give you the good news that God's perception of us is limitless. Limitless. And He is still ready, always ready, in His faithfulness, to bring you in to this place of supernatural lifestyle. That we are not going to read about men and women who prayed over the 5 roast potatoes and fed 20 people. And there was some over. But that is going to become our reality. In the early days of ministry, we had a knock on our door, and in came, well, at the door were standing 5 little children from a township near us called Ocean View, and they said, "Good evening, Pastor. We've come to sleep at your house." And we said, "Look, that's not going to happen, because what will your moms and dads say? Where are you? They will be looking for you. But do come in." And we got our 3 little children who were little tots and said, "These little ones have come to have supper with us. We want you to butter the rolls and serve them." And we had rolls, butter, and apricot jam. We prayed over the rolls, and we gave them the rolls, and we made them big cups of coffee with lots of milk and 4 sugars or whatever they had those days. And we loaded them in the car, and we took them home, found out each house, and said they came over to visit. We pastors, and we've brought the children home. So now we got back home. And there was a knock on the door, another knock. And there stood our neighbor, who was a fisherman on the boats at Cork Bay. And those fishermen that work day and night out of that Cork Bay harbor, they sell their fish. That's their income. Our neighbor never brought home fish. And this night he stood there with 2 packets of fish. And there was enough food for us and for just about everybody in our little home fellowship that we had built up. We were able to go from door to door and give everybody fish from the blessing of the Lord that brings increase and adds no sorrow. And so when I say we need to live by the supernatural, first of all, we've got to cancel the limitation that we have put on God and on ourselves. And we got to, like that painting, hear the waterfall of God call deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfall. If you're walking on a mountain walk, you will know when you get near to the waterfall. It is a thunderous sound. Whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. you know, that's a waterfall. That is the thunderous sound of liter upon liter, kiloliters of water dropping down a mountain face. We need to hear the thunderous sound of deep calling to deep. Father is calling his children now to get on to the airwaves, to pick up the clothe ourselves in the authority that he has given us and begin to preach the good news. I want to come back to the morning that we spoke about what is counterfeit and what is true, what is real. And do you remember that I spoke on that in the financial realm, they don't study counterfeits. There would be so many variations of what a counterfeit looks like. They only study the authentic note, money note, note of money. So that when a counterfeit comes, their eye will pick it up immediately. Because they have a grid in their mind of what the genuine thing looks like. So it is in the spirit. That we are not studying the works of darkness. That we are moving in the spirit of God's revelation and God's authentic call and gift. So that when another voice comes, we immediately know, this is not the voice of my shepherd. This is a voice of a stranger. And the word says there's only one way to come into that sheepfold. It is through the door, being Jesus Christ. And anyone that climbs over another way is a thief, and he will plunder you. So Father is aligning us with truth. He is truth. And that is being done in darkness is going to be exposed in his light. So it's bold of me to say this, but all of the agenda of man with its various shades and deceptions will be exposed. Every virus, every system of one world government, etc., etc., will be exposed. But we are not looking at that counterfeit. We are looking at our God. For he who's begun a work in you shall take you all the way through. All the way through. So now we need to give ourselves permission to live by the Spirit. So before I even go on, Father, right now, let's pray together. Father, right now, we want to repent for living on low doctrines and other people's opinions. I thank you, Father, that we are your children, your vessels, members of one body, filled with your Holy Spirit. And we say, Father, we open our hearts, we open that place where the river is meant to flow, and we invite you, Holy Spirit, to fill us afresh this morning with new oil, new wine, the pneuma breath of heaven, that you blow on us, that you fill us, fill, that you fill us, fill up, full and overflowing with the work of your Holy Spirit for service. For it's not by might nor by power, but by your Spirit, O God. Amen. So we've given God permission to let us be used in the realm of His Holy Spirit and not be running with messages that are going to tickle our ears, that we are in a sober season and yet will look like ones that are drunk at 10 in the morning. So it's the joy of the Lord, it's the anointing of God, it's the overflow of the Holy Spirit, at the same time with divine wisdom and understanding of how to administer that. Do you know, in the last 5 years, maybe 7 years, we had been calling Holy Spirit into our meetings, all of us. But when heaven has come in a weighted anointing, let's be honest and say that we have not always known what to do. I believe that Jesus, Father, Holy Spirit, have been faithful and turned up every time. For where two or three gather, He's in the midst of us, but we've not always been able to discern because the wick was not trimmed. There was not a hungering and thirsting for the work of the Holy Spirit. And so we would just go through our program, even on a religious calendar. And so Father is saying now, Jackie, your dance says, while you were praying, I saw an ear, hand, and heart, and I just wanted to share that. So God's ear is open, and our ear is open. God's hand is not short, it's extended to us. And God's heart is ready to receive us. I think we're in a season of enlisting into the supernatural company. Whoa, I feel such an anointing on that. Are you ready to be part of God's supernatural company? Are you ready to be part of God's invitation to be part of a supernatural company? Wow. I believe right now that the Council of Heaven is here. And we have been offered an invitation to be part of God's supernatural company. He's called out ones, He's firebrand. He's burning ones. A bride that is making herself ready. Yes, Lord, we are ready. And in the areas of our lives that we are not ready, will you make us ready? Come, Holy Spirit, we want to be part of an end time supernatural company of people. enable us, Lord, to look at what is happening, but at the same time that it will not overwhelm us, but will fill us with ammunition and equipment that we'll be able to divert atrocities that are coming to the earth. For your word clearly says that the days will be shortened and there will be an acceleration of your plan for the sake of the elect. Father, may we, the elect, those that are being called, those that have answered to your call, may we hasten the days by our intercession and our prayer. I ask you, Lord, to baptize us afresh in your Holy Spirit and to give us the gifts that are needed for this harvest time. I see that, I just feel the joy of Father, and that this anointing of an end time harvest that he's pouring out on us this morning is going to operate with great joy, great expectation. What took years and years to build is going to be birthed in an instant. Thank you for your invitation, Lord. Thank you for that we are qualified by the blood of Jesus. Wash us afresh this morning in your waterfall and fill us. Fill us. New and fresh revelation. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. May we pursue you as you pursue us. May your word be in our mouth. May we rescue the dying. May we rescue the perishing. We love you so much, and we want to present a harvest to you. The heart's cry is like the heart cry, I think it was David, that said he would not give the Lord anything that didn't cost him something. I thank you that the cost was paid at Calvary. But I ask, Father, that there will be a baptism of fire. That our hearts will burn inside of us. That we will reach this generation that is on the earth. That we'll honor those that have gone before, even the blood of the martyrs, even those of your disciples that laid a good word upon the foundation of Jesus Christ. May we get a glimpse that we are not in isolation of your love story. That it's now our time. Just as they would run with the international flame for the Olympic Games, and it's got all its connotations. We don't want man's torch. We want your torch. We want to pray over the sick and see them recovered. We want the anointing to be a reality and not something that we've read in a book. So we thank you for the infilling of your Holy Spirit for an end time company and the baptism of fire that fires us up. I just see a picture of a really dark sea and people bobbing up and down on that sea with their hands outstretched, and then the Father sending in his end time company and snatching them out of a place where they feel like they are drowning. Father, I also pray as we stand together this morning for many, 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 many workers in your field, leaders, apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists, that is so shaken now because the system has collapsed and they don't know which way to turn. And I pray, Father, that you will not, that they will not fall away in this time. We release your grace, your grace, your grace, your grace, your grace, and your faith on them. Fear not, my little flock, says the Lord. Fear not. For I have not only put my hand on you, I've put my hand inside of you. I'm the one that directs your paths. I'm the way, one that will see that you will complete this race and this life that I have put upon you. Know that as you even continue to do the things that you did at first, there's going to be a return on that that's going to come quickly, says the Lord. Things that took 3, 5, and 7 years to manifest will manifest within hours and within weeks. Be expectant and be ready, says the Father. For I will cause you to be my flaming torches, my flames of fire. And the company of heaven will assist you, even as you will see this harvest coming into focus now. Father says this is not a time to run and hide. This is a time to be separated in unto him. So I thank you, Father. Thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. I thank you that this has been a morning of impartation and a morning of like a recommissioning to a company of burning ones, to a company of flames of fire, to a company of supernatural revelation. This doesn't make us more high-minded, and this doesn't make us more gifted. This makes us more surrendered. Does the word of God not say, work while it is yet day, for the day will come that no man will be able to work anymore? Oh Lord Jesus, it's such a joy to answer to your invitation, your purpose, your revelation, your manifestation. There are many of you that feel like you've been sitting on the sidelines for so long, waiting for some man or woman to stir the water or open the gate. Father says, I have brought a tsunami so that the gate is not even in the same place anymore, the natural gate. But don't forget that I am the door. Lift up ye heads, O ye gates. Be lifted up, you everlasting door. That's us. Be lifted up. Why? So that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. He is the King of glory. Selah. Those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will rise up as on wings as eagles. They will run and not faint. They will walk and not grow weary and run and not faint. For in the natural, youths even grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who wait on the Lord, Father, our heart response this morning is our hearts burn within us at your visitation. And we are honored and excited to be able to honor you in our ways, in our deeds, in our attitude, in our protocol. We honor you. We honor you. We honor you. Almighty God, there is none like you. There is none like you. All the things on the earth become strangely dim in the light of your glory and grace. Thank you, Father. May your baptism, Father God, empower and equip us in such a way that places of disappointment and brokenness are seen no more. For as your anointing courses through our DNA, I pray that the troubles of this life and the things that have crushed us are swept away like when a deluge of rain comes and even the leaves are carried away on the water. Let our report be that we are whole in Jesus Christ. And not camp any longer at that mountain of self-help. That we will be kind to ourselves, singing songs and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in our hearts, rejoicing in our God, turning our face towards heaven, running in the lanes that you have set for us, rescuing the dying, preaching to the perishing, unusual ways with great efficiency and effectiveness. Thank you that our wicks have been trimmed this morning and we have received fullness of oil and we have awoken from our slumber. And we are part of an end time supernatural company. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I feel incredibly dishonoring of the moment that God has given us. If I now go back into the chat room mode and start giving out words, I want to leave you with the goodness of God all over you. I want you to incubate God's presence Jude 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up. On your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some, have compassion, making a distinction, but on others, save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garments defiled by the flesh. This is your commission. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To God our Saviour, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Have a wonderful day. God bless you. May the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be your ever-present portion.